I think that that's happened because, like, we've been assuming, like you said, that our leaders are
sure.
acting in our interests. And I,
exactly
but,
right.
but what I think we're realizing now is that there's been a group of people that have a very deliberate plan
right.
to wage an assault on our culture, on our borders, on our schools, on all of our institutions, our courts, and they have, to a large part, succeeded in that. We see, mm-hmm. somebody else said that our courts have shifted into a progressive court system, our schools have shifted into a progressive education system, and I think a lot of us are worried because it seems like a lot of us are awake and we are active and we are concerned, but there's really not going to be anything we can do unless we get our people
right.
you know, back into these positions. And there are still a lot of people from the other side. When I say the other side, I
sure.
mean the progressive movement that are hiding in our party, that are
right.
pretending they're Republicans because
right.
they want to stay in power and keep implementing this attack. Like she said, you know, you call a company here, you call an American company, and the first thing you hear on the phone is Spanish.
Right.
You
right.
get a brochure in your medicine bottle, half of it's in Spanish.
Right.
Or since when did we become a half Hispanic country? I mean, look at the TV these days. Look at the commercials on TV. You would think that over half of our country is a minority.
Right. I think that the reality is, though, and to your point, is that we also have to recognize that it's not just the deterioration didn't just come from a lack of attention or apathy. It also came from the fact that there is a movement with a deliberate movement with an
yes.
ideology that is very much in contradiction, I believe,
to our
founding principles, to our Judeo-Christian values, to freedom and capitalism. And so it's not just that we fell asleep at the switch.
Right.
It's also that there is this effort pushing the other way to take us in the direction of being much more like a European socialist welfare state, much more in tune with the progressive principles and progressive view of larger government, of more dependency. So I think that's what we're fighting against, and I think that's what I mentioned earlier about the ideological divide that is finally becoming much more apparent as people wake up and see which direction we're going to go in.
Right. It's not, you know, I don't mean to imply that we were all asleep at the wheel either, because I think we were equally deceived by people that,
sure, sure.
That set out to deceive the
and
people.
I think the biggest issue, though, too, is to ensure that it's not just about splitting the difference either. You know, for far too long, one side came out with a plan, the other side came out with a plan, and so instead of $1 trillion, it was $500 billion, and everyone, you know, patted themselves on the back and said, oh, that's great.
That's your call.
So I think the reality is that we need to do a better job.
Oh,
someone's getting a ticket. We need to do a better job of articulating our views so that we don't end up in a situation where we have to make compromises on our principles. And that's what we're seeing now in Washington, I think. I think we're seeing that now where Republicans are saying, well,
well,
we can't get a good deal, so
right.
maybe this, you know, maybe just making it smaller is better.
I have to call Mitch McConnell's office every day, and John Boehner's office
yeah.
every day. And it doesn't really matter. That's how I feel. It doesn't matter that we call, because Mitch McConnell comes out yesterday and is giving away the store and saying, well, we'll just let Obama
right.
do all of this.
Yeah.
I mean, they say, oh, well, maybe this is a good idea. It's not a good idea. I mean, Mitch McConnell needs to go.
I think the reality of where we are right now is that there's just such a disconnect between what's going on in Washington and what's taking place out in the rest of the country. And one thing that I think we're too worried about are the electoral consequences. And I know a lot of people say, well, if we don't win the elections in 2012, then we're not going to be
too
able,
late.
Exactly. And so I think what's critical for us right now, we need to say this is our plan, and we need to go out to the American people and do a better job of explaining why that plan is going to create jobs, grow the economy, how it's going to solve the other problems that we face, and we need to get the American people behind us.
Can I say something about articulating the point? We understand when you say discretionary spending or entitlement
right.
spending, but I think there are a lot of people out there that when they hear that, like, we need to cut discretionary spending, we need to cut entitlement, they don't really know what that means. I think some people assume that they're going to lose something, and it needs to be followed up by what that means is...
The biggest issue, though, is that we're at a point now where nearly 50% of people are not paying any taxes, paying any income taxes in this country. And that goes back to my point about Obamacare, which is that once you reach that tipping point of more people who are on the taker side than on the maker side, once you reach that point, it's very difficult to recover from. And so that's why it's about awakening people who believe in the promise of America to be a part of our movement, to be a part of our viewpoint for the future of the
and
country.
Explaining to them what you just said, that that's what's happening, that's what the entitlement, that's what the all this spending on entitlement, that's what that means. I don't know if a lot of people realize what that means. That means that more money is being taken from the producers and given to the producers, and that's not a sustainable path.
No, we've seen
Adam, in keeping with that, I read an article in the St. Pete Times right after you announced your candidacy that they said that you weren't considered a very good representative because you did not bring home the bacon. What do you say to that?
I think it's a demonstration that's not the job of a legislator, of an elected representative. I think people recognize there are legitimate government spending projects. I certainly believe that, and that might not be in tune perfectly with what everybody thinks, but there are things that government needs to spend money on, and so I'm not somebody who's anti-government, but I think government needs to do a better job of how it spends the money and what it spends it on. And I think where people are so frustrated today, and what I've sensed as I've traveled the state, is that they just no longer trust that the money that's being spent is on the right things and that it's not being wasted. And so I think I'm going to be judged on my record from serving in the legislature of having a conservative voting record during my time in the legislature, and I'm going to be judged on my views on the issues that now are confronting our nation in Washington, and I'm going to be judged on whether I'm the person who can beat Bill Nelson in 2012, and I think across the board on all three of those that I'm the right Republican to go to Washington to challenge the status quo on both sides, Democrats and Republicans who act like him. And I've proven it when I was in the legislature, and I'll prove it in Washington.
How important is it going to be for the House of Representatives to say majority Republican control, then the Senate to become
If we don't take back control of the United States Senate, if we don't win back the White House, I think it's both, and maintain the majority in the Congress. I'm not sure the types of things that we want to do are going to be possible because of what you pointed out a minute ago, that there is a push from the ideological left, from the progressive movement, that wants to take our country in a much different direction. So that's why this is a battle. This is a battle of ideas. This is a battle of ideology, and we can't be afraid of it. Charlie Crist, during his last State of the State, referenced me indirectly in his speech and called me part of the people who are too concerned about ideology. And my response to that was, ideology is not a four-letter word. Mm-hmm. And I really believe that it's your principles, it's what you believe. It's not to say that you can never reach a compromise with somebody who may not agree with you, but not to compromise on your core beliefs, on your core principles. And so if we don't take back control of the Senate, if we don't have a strong 57, 58, up to 60 vote majority in the Senate and the White House, then I think the plans that we have are going to be significantly restricted.
I think that's going to have to be the last. I'm getting a signal from somebody over here wearing a tie and a jacket, which is unusual.
He has a clipboard.
And he's got the next senator's.
And thank you guys so much for coming out, Rich. Yeah. Thank you for your support.
By the way, where are you going to be today? You're going to go to lunch at the South Sarasota Republican Club
in Venice.
In Venice.
Can I get one more question? David Brooks wrote an article called something about the Republican Party needs to become normal again, or it's not a normal party. I read it and fired off a letter to everybody about that one. What do you call normal for the Republican Party? Do you call normal the status quo?
I think David Brooks, ever since he had that dinner with Barack Obama right after he got elected, has kind of been under some different type of spell, maybe. So
thanks a lot, everybody.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Support local business.
All right.
Thank you so much, and I appreciate it.